right by the investment guy there. That's right after Edward Jones. Okay, right at that curve, and it'll be positioned in a way so that as you're coming up, you'll get to see that for the maximum amount of time as you're coming in. Okay, we expect that it will be lighted, and it'll be sitting off to the side there. The efforts that were reported in the paper were a little bit premature in terms of getting that done, and those were not done with the auspices of the community club. They were done by an individual. Okay, so there will be a replacement sign there, and we're also looking at what other types of gateway welcoming do we want to do as you drive up and into the actual Glade proper. Okay, so there's a lot to be done, and there's money in the budget to do that next year, end of year.
The gentleman over here had a question.
Right here.
The gentleman right here. You have the mic already, sir. Go ahead.
No.
Oh,
no,
I'm sorry. Go ahead. You have the speed limit? Go, go, go.
Okay, so I just talked to my TDOT representative or contact that I have. He stated that it is going to go back up to 45. He says that they're going to submit a proposal whenever it gets to Weigel's, whenever it gets to the entrance of Fairfield, to be 35, not 30 anymore. But at this time, that's the answer that I have. So it possibly could go up to 35 at Weigel's. But going to the interstate after Weigel's would be back to 45.
Okay, great. Thank you. That was quick. Yes, sir.
Right. You mentioned that workforce is a bit of an issue. And I'm talking now within the Glade, not construction, but services industry. It's my understanding that various resorts up and down the east and west coast use some kind of a Title V or something initiative through the government to get college kids from Europe or Asia or something like that to come in seasonally who can speak English and are willing to work in resort-type areas. Is that something you've looked at as well, or are you familiar with that?
That's really a management thing. The what you're saying is true. A lot of communities and clubs, the program is referred to as a workaway program, and these workers come from all over the world, and there are companies that specialize in that. There are variations to that. There's a variation where people just move, say, from Florida. They'll work there in the winter and then come north and work the busy season back and forth. My understanding is that management is looking at some of those things. That's more of an operational thing and looking at specifically how to do that. Our charge is to encourage some investigation of that. But I don't know, and has there been any board activity on that, or anybody have any details on that? Jeannie, do you have something on that? We'll get you a microphone back there. There you go, Jeannie, right behind you.
Oh, thank you. I can say that our human resource department has investigated that for the benefit of the food and beverage department. And what we're looking at, it's kind of a major undertaking should we choose to do that. And it is to bring people in, and then we have to house them.
Right.
Then we also pay for their services, obviously, and kind of manage them and take care of them. So it's being investigated as an option. No final determination has been made.
Great. And the housing piece is a significant part of that. Where that works, because these folks are coming from Europe, and think about, where are they going to live? It's not going to work if they're living in Cookeville or Crossville. So that is underway, and HR is looking at that. That's great news. Okay.
One of the things our committee looked at, and we don't have jurisdiction over this, we're just raising issues and trying to get people to focus on that. But we really, our message to the county and to state officials is that we need to be engaged in this. Fairfield Glade is a partner in this process. We have a lot to offer. If you look at the resources that we bring to bear, the experiences that you all have had in your careers before you retired, or if you, all those things, that can have an influence on workforce development, labor market development, all those things. And we feel that it's important for us to make ourselves available to work with the county and try to, the education system, make them aware, of what these resources might be. So we've just encouraged the mayor in our discussions with him and some other people, that we need to be working it. The county needs to be doing this. We want to be a part of that. We want to be a part of those discussions.
gentleman back here, and then we'll come over here. Gentleman in the red there, yes, sir, and then this gentleman here.
First of all, I'd like to commend the committee and all their hard work. I know that it's a tough task.
We thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.
Just a few questions. One is, all the recommendations still stay consistent with our charter, state charters, a homeowners association?
As far as we know, yes. Was there one that you were concerned about, or just a general question?
No, just a general question that, we're still chartered as a 503C3
right.
homeowners association.
Correct. Nothing we would recommend would go outside.
That won't change. I mean, right. This is all done within the context of
the... The other thought that I had is that in the threats portion, I know that was in the last session, but in going forward, we still have a concern, or I have a concern, of the wind farm returning. So is there any thoughts about our governmental relationships concerning the wind farm?
Well, I guess nothing is ever completely over, but I think that this community, working with others in the county, were very successful in helping get legislation passed that Cameron Sexton, Paul Bailey sponsored, that will make it very, very difficult for any developer to bring wind farm or wind energy to this county, in fact, even probably to the state for that matter. But as far as the immediate threat to us, I feel really confident that that's over with. No company is really going to take a look at that and want to go through what Apex went through, spend the money that they did, and then have to pull out at the very end. So I'm pretty confident about that. And we have educated people a lot more about this now than it was, 3 years ago when they first started to come in this. And there's a lot more pushback on this kind of thing. So I think it's done.
Well, interrupt for a second. Officer Friendly over there just told me that the option of going to 35 once you're in the Glade got rejected, so it's going to remain 30. So it will not be faster. Thank you.
Can I just say something more about the wind farm? We still have these power lines.
Yep.
Harry.
We still have the power lines. We are safe. They're not going to do anything here, but there are power lines, so other counties are at risk, not at us. So it's not a done deal, but more than likely it's a done deal. A lot of it's going to have to do with TVA. And they don't really like wind farms, but they got a new guy in charge. And so we don't know what he's going to do. But I think our county is pretty safe because they have too many restrictions. But counties to the west, counties to the east, we don't know what they're going to do. But I think for us, it's pretty much a moot subject. So.
The gentleman here had a question. Right here in the front?
Right here, there you go.
Yeah, actually this is a slight backup to one that was done a few moments ago. Referring to that entry sign, I realize that person did jump the gun and on their own presented a possibility of a sign. My personal opinion is it was an awesome sign. It deserves being considered. My question is, does the Strategic Planning Committee, how do you feel about reaching out to those of us who have skills in a particular thing instead of just saying, well, we're going to go look and hire somebody. Let's pay somebody to design a sign. When you have people here in Fairfield Glade, they have skills that are amazing. And do we have a plan to tap into those people and say, we are going to put a sign up. We will accept submissions. Or we are going to paint the light poles pink. Do we have any submissions to how to do that?
Well, that's an operational issue. As Bill said earlier, we're looking at issues that are as far as 10 years in advance. We're not looking at painting light poles pink. We're not looking at putting up signs. But that's an issue for Bob Weber and the management team and the board, and Jeannie's got something to say about it. So.
If you have read your e-blast that just came, we would love to have input from the community, from the people who have skills. Every committee is accepting new people onto their committees, and we love to have people under direction doing things. It's wonderful. We want your skills. Please sign up for a committee. Everyone's open.
We got openings in our group, in our committee next year. We'd love to have some more people.
And to the gentleman's point, one of the things about our committee is, if you think about the five recommendations, they're going to break down into smaller tasks. When we get to that step, we will be looking to the committee, to the community for expertise, because we have whatever expertise the nine of us have. Our knee-jerk reaction is not to go hire a consultant. If we have professional experience here within the community, we certainly want to tap that. So whether it's a strategic initiative or something as operational as the sign or painting or whatever, I think there's a great openness to that. And you did mention that there was an outreach just this week about that. So
well, the advertisement has been out for volunteers to join the committees, but I want to make a direct comment to that. If you remember last year, a year ago when we went through the election, one of the things that we focused on was that we wanted to see more involvement from the community. Okay, first thing that happened was we formed Food and Beverage Committee. Jeannie is basically working with that group. These are all retired executive chefs, purchasing guys that worked for large food companies, that sort of thing. We went ahead and formed the Governmental Relations Committee, and we have lobbyists on that, we have community activists on that, we have attorneys on that, we have a former judge on that committee to do that. And then just recently, we created the Capital Projects Committee, and Bruce is working with them, and those guys are all retired professional engineers that have managed major construction companies, and from a financial perspective, we are very optimistic that when we look at projects like Stonehenge Clubhouse, when we look at the Racket Center projects, the dollars that we have allocated in the budget for that, we believe we're going to see significant savings on that by having these guys involved in the bidding of the project and in managing the project throughout. So, you know, we're open to other specialty committees like that, because this is a major operation now. It's a big company. It's a $21 million company. And, you know, most of the time you don't run that with just a handful of people. So we're looking for volunteers.
I just want to make one comment.
I'm sorry. Did you want to follow up, sir?
Yeah.
Go ahead.
My point was kind of missed because what I was saying is possibly this person, you know, designed this thing, doesn't want to be on a committee, but he wants to say, here's something I am offering. Would somebody take a look at this? It's not a total of it's a one-shot thing. Mm-hmm. This person says, I can offer a solution to this one-time problem. And this is what's not being looked at, I think. That's just my own opinion.
I think that's something that obviously we'd want to take a look at and try to encourage that as best we can. I think we could do it in the context of we're looking at an overall workforce development strategy and taking advantage of the skills and resources that we have here in our community. And so I think in that context, that certainly will be brought up and addressed at an appropriate time, because I think you raise a valid point. Before we move on, though, I do want to just make one commercial out of two that I'm going to make. But the one commercial I want to make is for the SBC. We do have openings on it. If you are interested in this type of thing, we do need some members. So I think an email just went out with instructions on how to apply. The deadline is tomorrow. This has been out there for quite a while. So I just want to encourage you, if you're interested in this, please consider applying for appointment. And it's a lot of work, but it's very rewarding, and you get to work with great people. So yes, anyway, I want to say that. So, okay.
Gentleman right here.
Yes, with the completion of Peavine Road and our continued efforts trying to build and grow the community, some of the real beneficiaries of all that work are the businesses that are on or going to be on Peavine Road. One thing y'all might want to consider thinking about is the development of a Chamber of Commerce for Peavine Road, because it would be in their best interest to pursue further marketing of this area. Since they are the major beneficiaries, it might be able to take some of the workload cost off of Fairfield Glade Community Club.
It's a good idea.
Back there. I just didn't want to forget that. I'm getting the other gentleman's the single topic volunteer. We'll capture that also.
I have two water questions. I have two water questions. How long do we expect our current water to last, considering 100 new home starts a year? And what is Crab Orchard doing about supplying more water?
Want to go to the Crab Orchard water guy?
Pat's liaison of the
Pat Gruway.
Hi, I'm Pat Gruway, and I'm on the Government Relations Committee also, but I've been the liaison for about 9 years to Crab Orchard with another gentleman called Bernardo Rico. We stay in touch with Crab Orchard, but unfortunately, it is a private utility. We, as residents here, are obviously their number one account. We're the bulk of their business, but they have finally realized, and I can attest to this, that there will be eventually a problem if something doesn't get addressed very soon. I can tell you this, the mayor is concerned. It was part of his issue when he ran for election as the mayor of Cumberland County, and he's on top of it along with the three-man board and a guy by the name of Everett Bolin, who was the general manager there. And in the last meeting, they have finally come to the conclusion, I can say this with all the assurances that I can, that a regional water authority will probably be the way to go, and they will be meeting in either January or February. This will encompass not just only Cumberland County, but some surrounding counties. This will be a major, major expense. But the only thing I can tell you, be patient. It is being worked on, I can assure you. We're concerned like anybody, because without water, we're dead in the water, pardon the English. We have a good power supply here with VEC, but water will be a looming issue unless we address it, and we are addressing it. I can assure you of that.
Do you have any estimates on how long our current water supply will last based on 100 new homes a year?
Well, I'll be very frank with you, based on our population and everything, we are pretty secure with at least 5 years, but it's going to take a couple of years to put this together. The current system now is a lake behind the Shell station. Unfortunately, it's only approximately 95 acres, and it's about 100 feet deep in the middle, and it is fed by Mother Nature. Very few springs on this mountain. So what we're going to have to do is, sooner or later, there has to be another source. And there are some other areas that they're looking at. And this will take some time. I mean, it just isn't going to be done overnight. And it'll probably have to have some government intervention, I'm pretty sure. But anyway, it's being worked on, I can assure you. We'll be giving you some updates. Probably what you have to do is wait until the first of next year. And then I think the updates will start coming out.
But Pat, you said at this point you have assurance for the next 5 years at least, no problem?
Yeah, and I know, you know, like infrastructure issues are really in everybody's mind, you know, like water and sewer and electrical power, the grid, all that stuff. So that's not being ignored. But you know, there's a lot of people involved in this. It goes well beyond, you know, what our capabilities are. Yes, right here, we had a quip, sorry. Thank you. I knew there was...
Kind of piggybacking on your suggestion about the sign, it kind of hit me. I don't know how good of an idea this is, but maybe have a contest, and whoever has the best design of a sign can win free dinner at Legends or something like that.
Well, it's got to be better than just one dinner. Come on, it's a sign for the whole community here. We're talking about at least two dinners, right? Okay, contest.
I got one right here.
Do we have any more information from the developer on what his plans are? It must be kind of hard to strategically plan when you don't know what his ideas are. Is he going to do a restaurant or a coffee shop?
Well, this is really part of the first recommendation we have, which is to start working on a master plan. I think what we've done in the past, I've only been here 3 years, but I've kind of looked back at the history of the community, and a lot of things that have happened have happened kind of out of context. As we need this, we need that, we'll do this, we'll improve that. What we're looking to do is work with all the stakeholders. That's the developer, Wyndham, the county, to have a bigger plan. What are we going to do with this place? You know, we're in year 49, soon to be year 50. Where do we want to be in year 60, year 70, whatever? So the developer is only part of that. And so it's a great question. The good news is that all of those partners are very enthusiastic about being involved in this. Now, this still needs to be approved by the board. This is a recommendation, really, that we're making to the community today and getting feedback on it. And based on the feedback we get, we'll move forward and make the formal recommendation to the board at the meeting in September. But I think that that is the prudent way of going forward, is to get all of these stakeholders involved so that we all have a picture of where is this thing going over the next few years. So it's not just the developer, it's also Wyndham, it's also our own land. What are we going to do with that? Because we own a lot of land, and the county. And that's the number one recommendation, is to get going on that master plan.
And there's a lot of, we can't do anything until somebody else does something, and they can't do anything until somebody else does something. So we've got to get that all together so that we can have this master plan, so that everybody has a pretty good understanding of what this is going to look like and who's responsible for what and so forth. So that's one of the things that we've really tried to encourage, and we'll be, working with the board, and then I know the board is interested in this. So I think that that's probably one of the most important recommendations that's coming out of this.
Well, we were on a phone call with him about 3 weeks ago, mm-hmm. And he's expressed a strong desire in helping with the master plan. So it's something that he would like to participate in, and obviously it's important to have him on board. So he'd like to do that, and I think he's working with the board and with Bob Weber on what dates he's going to be in town so we can get together and start the process.
Other questions, comments, feedback? Gentleman here.
I just joined the wellness facility recently, enjoy it, but I've heard some discussion, I don't know how much of this is true, is that Covenant's facility in the city of Crossville may be closing soon due to what I'd heard was increased competition from 24-hour and others, and that load of patients and people using it may come here, which maybe you all know this already, it would seem to have an impact on this facility and may expand the need to do something with what your recommendation is. I don't know if you all have heard this or not, or if the statement is even true.
We've heard some different variations on that. Does anybody have an actual understanding of what's going on?
I would like to just quickly address this. I have been working very closely with Covenant over the last 4 or 5 years. Covenant saved this hospital. 6 or 7 years ago, it was ready to go belly up. They have put $55 million into this facility and over $130 million into East Tennessee with their various facilities. They are a for-profit. They're a business. But without them, we'd be in big trouble. We are, by the way, one of 20 hospitals in the state of Tennessee out of the 64 that got an A rating. Unheard of for Cumberland County, let me tell you. Cookeville Regional, our biggest competitor, got a C. We got the A rating. That's number one. Number two, we have a very astute chairman of the board of Covenant here by the name of David Bunch, who has done a wonderful job of putting this hospital together and keeping it very secure. It is difficult to entice top flight medical people to come to Cumberland County, but he's working on it. But do not be misled by rumors. I promise you, Covenant has made an amazing obligation. I was at a luncheon with their chairman of the board a couple of months ago, and they've made a real commitment to this hospital, I can assure you. So feel secure. They're doing a good job.
I think the question, though, was more about the fitness center and their commitment to that. And I guess there have been some rumors of closing one or the other facilities. And does anybody have details on that?
I asked the folks over here
yes, sir.
Monday. They said it's closing on the 1st of September downtown.
Downtown.
So downtown will close on the 1st of September.
Okay. And so there is some speculation that people will come out to visit us here then?
That's...
Right.
I know that, you know, one of the recommendations that you saw, and we've been talking about it, and we are going to focus on it, is that we do need to have a better facility than what we've got here, and we need to be doing things to encourage that development. And that's one of the things that our commercial development group would be asked to look into and figure out what's the best way to approach this.
And also from a master planning standpoint, if you start looking at the big picture, then you start asking questions like, I'm sure this will start the rumor mill, should we do our own thing? Do we bring somebody else in? You know, these alternatives have not really been considered, and I'm not suggesting that. But when you do a master plan, you start looking at a lot of different alternatives. How do we work with Covenant? Where are they going in the future? What are they trying to accomplish? How could we complement that? Is there something else we might do? So the master plan is really the top recommendation that we're making to drive a lot of decisions. Things that you guys are asking about will end up falling into that master plan. It's a question about a restaurant, question about fitness. All of that has to be addressed in a master plan. Before you pull the trigger, you got to have an idea of what this thing's going to look like.
And health and wellness will be a big part of that. You know, that's not going to be ignored in any master plan that's being developed. That'll be one of the big components of that.
Just a comment on the wellness, fitness closing in town. My understanding is a lot of it, or the reason it's closing is because they're losing a lot of customers to Anytime Fitness and Planet.
Planet Fitness, right.
Yep.
So the indication would be maybe we don't have a flood of people coming here, is your contention? I guess we'll find out. It closes when? Next week, did somebody say?
First of September.
Okay.
2 weeks.
Other questions? Comments? Gentleman in the back. Right behind you, sir.
So I'd just like to thank all the committee members that are here and the board members that are here to volunteer their time. Thank you. My question is regarding future amenities. Do you guys have any ideas of what new future amenities might be, indoor and outdoor? I like the idea of the billiards lounge. And also, talking about our wellness center here, is it possible to throw in the mix an area that you wouldn't have to pay a monthly fee to go and use a treadmill or weights like that, so something that would be, you know, located in this building or a future building that would be for members not having to join the Wellness Center membership?
A couple of different points there. Let's go to the fitness, all of that. Again, that master plan would be looking at things like that. We had a number of things like meeting rooms. There's a shortage of meeting rooms. Those of you who are in various committees and various groups trying to get a room, and we are aware of that. When you start talking about things like that, then you start talking about where would they be and is this building the right building, and that's the master plan thing. What do we do with this building? Does it remain like it is? So a lot of those kinds of questions start to build the framework of the master plan, of the buildings that we have now, and of things that we might do in the future. As far as amenities go, and David really did tremendous research on this, there wasn't much that we don't have. We don't have polo ponies.
We don't have a zip line.
We don't have a zip line. What else did we have? I mean, on the list of amenities, there was only a couple of things. The lounge, a true billiards pool thing, you know, an actual room. Certainly, our bocce facility is not competitive with what you see in other communities, but there weren't major things that we were missing. There are upgrades that we need to make.
We looked at 75 different comparable communities, and we didn't look at anything with less than 500 homes, and we didn't look at anything that wasn't fully developed. We weren't looking at, 100.